one is taking it. They're backing off. Uzi's going in. Expect needs to go mega, but it's too little, too late. Uzi is cutting through G2. Expect finally gonna knock Uzi to the wall, but it does not matter. Perks get out for free, but it's G2 who pay the price.
Hello and welcome to another edition of Worlds Tonight as we round out week one of the group stages here in Wuhan, China. Still much more to go, but let's break down today a day very unlike any other. By the way, I'm Riving to Bismuth III, Zach Rusty Pie, and Sam Kobe Hartman Kensler. Everybody thought this was kind of going to go top to bottom, as it should, win for win, but it was much closer than expected.
Yeah, a couple of surprises happened today. First and foremost, the Koreans didn't look invincible, unless you're Longju, of course. They looked absolutely unstoppable, but a couple of exciting games for me. I'm an LPL caster. LPL went 2-0. I'm a pretty happy camper.
Yeah, there was that. There was also a Nasus pick, and then ended up winning one of the fastest games in World's history.
I can't wait to get into it all. Let's bring up the standings and kind of see how everything played out, what things look like now, because it changed up a little bit. Obviously, we see down there for Group D, Flash Wolves, a bit of the misfits of the group sitting on the outside, and we'll get to them in a little bit, but we have to bring up the last game of the day, G2 versus RNG. Basically a nail biter, but only towards the end. 30 minutes of back and forth, nothing, and then explosion.
Uzi versus Sven. This was a huge one. So exciting to watch. You know, a couple of the team fights there, but Uzi on this switch, I don't believe he died the entire game. And even though they got pushed in and they, you know, lost turret pretty early, being able to farm up and come back with the coordination of the rest of the team, huge sniping out people in those team fights.
Yeah, there was some moments, and of course this is the big team fight you'll see from Uzi where G2 nicely line up for him as a Twitch to spray and pray them all down, but that Jace in the composition, they had some things that you wouldn't expect to, you know, entirely scale up and be this late game threat, and honestly it still did a lot of work. They just had to protect the Twitch.
Kobe, I kind of want to touch on that, a little uncharacteristic. A lot of the casters thought, or even people on social media, that they just throw an all AD comp in knowing that they have a pretty good idea of what the meta run is. What did you think?
Yeah, I didn't like the Jace pick because you're just two DPS there, Twitch, and then you're adding another AD. And Jace is also a lethality using AD, so it seemed a bit scary. Ended up not hurting them at all. You know, things like Corki and stuff we were thinking about would probably be better to mix up the damage types. But the one thing that Jace does bring over Corki is the acceleration gate, and they actually utilize the speed several times to get those engagements. And the positioning we were talking about for Uzi, he was utilizing the acceleration gate. That's how he got one of his, you know, side swipes there, where he was able to sneak around and flank.
And it's good that you noticed it. It's something that often goes unnoticed, is just the acceleration gate doing anything besides accelerating the shock blast. So it was very well done from them to use that at all. And yeah, it was another big thing, another notch in the belt for the 3-0 RNG.
And how do we feel about kind of G2 moving on now? It seems a bit of a fluster here before we move on to our next game. Any thoughts there? Obviously, RNG with the wins feels good, but where do we see G2?
I still think G2 looked pretty strong. Even though they're 1-2 now, Samsung actually showed some weakness as well, even though they were able to come out ahead in their game. So I still think that there is possible movement in this group, and it's definitely still up in the air, especially between those three teams.
All right, Rusty, I want to start you on TSM versus Misfits, a 44-minute game that kind of, even I thought it was just going to be a TSM game.
Yeah, it ramped up pretty quickly, I think it's fair to say, from what was meant to just be this TSM game. Misfits got a win yesterday. They come in, it's their second game now in a row where they've been able to pick up the victory. But it was in a clutch way, in things you wouldn't expect. Team fighting with the LeBlanc, being able to hit those chains on a double lift. Almost characteristic mistakes from NA's AD carry superstar.
Right.
Yeah, there was definitely a huge story here for the bottom lane. TSM, they give up Xayah and take Kog'Maw over instead. Not very many teams have been willing to do that.
No.
And then they also were one of the first ones to bring out this Nami here. In the Ardent Sensor meta, when the Lulu is banned out and Janna was taken away, that was the answer there. And Nami is, you know, good for lane phase, but at the very beginning, level one, Double Lift goes up to harass on the red buff by himself, and Biofrost is not there with him. Ends up taking a huge amount of damage early on. And then with the Cold Start, like, you don't have as much pure stats for fighting after that, and they end up diving the bottom lane multiple times early on in the game and kind of snowballing off that.
And that is something I would suggest everyone goes back and watches as well. It's not just the concept from what Doublelift did. I actually like the idea as well of trading by having the Nami, but more the way that the Misfits 2v2 actually played that lane out, because almost picture perfect from Han Sama, who isn't exactly the most prestigious player running around on the Rift, and to be able to play it that well to then set up for the dives was honestly very impressive.
Also, I thought it was impressive that constant pressure from Misfits held TSM back. We knew in the NALCS these guys were the 45-minute team that were okay staving off a bunch of pressure just to win it. Kind of like SKT would a game, but no wombo combo came. Misfits looking fantastic now.
Yeah, that's a very much a style matchup thing, which is what made the NAEU in this case super exciting. As Misfits, if they get a lead, they're very good at using that lead, very good at getting victories with it. TSM, yes, maybe they're good at holding on, get those 45-minute team fights. Misfits shut them out.
And we can kind of stay in this group here. Flash Wolves, as I said before, the Misfits of this group, 0-3 to a bunch of cool kids sitting at the 2-1 group. How do we think this is going to play out with these three ties so far?
It is looking very, very bad for Flash Wolves at the moment, because TSM, Misfits, and WE all next week are going to be, you know, fighting for that top spot. And Flash Wolves, they just have so much ground to make up. I don't see it happening for them.
Yeah, nearly an impossible feat for them to achieve. They'll have to 3-0 and also ensure the stars align elsewhere to even be in the top two position for themselves. But the rest of the group, not just Flash Wolves, super close, very hard to call at the moment. I'm sure Kobe would have a preference to TSM. I'd be picking Team WE because that makes sense. And then you look at the third team in the group, even then, Misfits, surprising.
It's a wrench in there now. You just don't know.
Yeah.
Yeah, one of the best parts actually about that Misfits game too was how they kept up the pressure with the side waves and never let TSM have more than one option. Like, they were continually forced into what Misfits wanted them to do.
And let's talk about a little more of a spread out group. Let's head over to A. Obviously, SKT leading this group 3-0, showing a bit of their own falters, but you can kind of always expect SKT to share those up and get the win.
They're still 3-0 ultimately, right?
Exactly.
They've got the three wins. They've shown some shakiness. Yeah, they've been pushed to their limits. Maybe they should have lost to EDG is one thing we can take away from the current standings.
Yeah, EDG. How about we talk about them for a little while?
I don't want to talk about it for too long, Kobe. It still hurts. But they were so good, and then how quickly they fell.
It's been actually really impressive to see the fans saying thank you, or I'm sorry, EDG saying thank you, but the fans outside, when we leave at night, are still behind them, still believing, and they want to see it happen in week two for EDG.
They have had some heartbreaking losses there for EDG. I mean, a lot of the games that were close for a long time, a lot of good early games even, but they have not been able to pull together in the late game. Scout, you know, one of the star players for this team, you know, continually getting caught out, you know, by skill shots later on, and it's been very costly.
It's years of heartbreak for EDG. So the fans outside with the signs, they're used to it, Riv.
All right, Kobe, a 2-1 Cloud9, a pretty good silver lining there. How are you feeling about the chances here in Group A?
Cloud9 actually look even better than people expected. You know, in the play-ins, they actually dominated. Everyone's like, okay, well, you know, it's the play-ins and, you know, the strength of your opponents probably isn't going to measure up. But Cloud9 have equally stepped it up in this group. Specifically, I like to talk about contracts because this guy is still playing carry junglers. He's continually going with his DPS junglers. And specifically today, or not even today, yesterday, he pulled out the Graves in combination with the Shen from Impact. And it was absolutely outstanding. Nobody else is playing Graves. Nobody's going to expect Graves. It didn't exactly do like anything in particular super surprising.
He's great.
But he played it very well. And you could see it in contracts movements. He was very confident. Even, you know, talking about he probably hasn't played the champion in quite a long time, but very confident with the champion to move up with the Stan United on his back. And they had these really good engagements where Impact was absolutely destroying with that top lane Shen.
Yeah, to me, it was a direct counter to EDG as well. Scout loves to go forwards. What's a good way to stop Scout from going forwards?
More
have the counter ganker and have the Shen ult there as well.
All right, so as we move on to Group C, RNG gets to sit atop of this one. So we do have, obviously, a team from China wrecking house within the group stage. It's got to feel good.
Thank God. I could say we've got it. We're at the home crowd, and RNG are able to go 3-0. If you guys haven't heard them, they're absolutely insane anytime RNG does anything. I know Uzi got an MVP, and the crowd was the loudest I'd ever heard it of all things for them to go off about. They absolutely love that RNG is here, and they are playing incredible.
And it's been interesting to see kind of how today played out. We saw 1907 Fenerbahce having a few punches thrown at, I believe it was, where's this game? Samsung? Yes, it was Samsung Galaxy. I'm getting my head mixed up. But that was, Samsung did not like the result of that game. And it kind of makes you think of what could happen within this group with that much trouble being put to these other teams.
Yeah, I mean, for me, the trouble that was there for Samsung is something that will remain evident, I feel like, coming into the second week. 1907 Fenerbahce pushing them to the limits.
Right.
You know, everyone's natural excuse will then be, well, they changed their jungler and it was up against the third place team. So maybe that was the problem, but they lost everywhere. It was team decisions and 1907 Fenerbahce kept up with them. And that, to me, is the bigger concern, not just the jungle change. And does Ambition really do that much for the whole team for it to be that close?
I think they're of the opinion that yes.
Yeah.
As far as, you know, Papa Smithy talking to him all the time, he's just like, the team without Ambition just looks completely different. And it really was a stark difference to see it here on the world stage, right? For a team known for the late game to look lost at so many different points, you can definitely tell.
Yeah, you see, Ambition is the one to go in first and leave the party last, basically, for these guys. So seeing him not be there was pretty interesting. Looking at the rest of the group here in C, obviously G2 1-2, 1907 Fenerbahce 0-3, and G2 said not looking terrible, just not finding their wins, missed positions in the late game, and it's plaguing them to the end of the loss.
Yeah, G2 have got a little bit extra to go, but we are seeing all of these extra positives for them, and that's the one big thing I would take from that ultimately is no one should be like, all of these groups, except for the Koreans on the top and Fnatic perhaps and EDG, no one should be disheartened here at Worlds with how they have performed because they have so many extra things to work on, and now you've got the 3 days to do that. I feel like that's enough time, honestly, to get rid of some of these kinks.
Yeah, I mean, people were calling this one the group of death here with, you know, Samsung, RNG, and G2 all heavily battling for those two spots. I still think that's true, you know, even with RNG here sitting atop 3-0.
All right, and we can move on to the final group we'll be seeing next week on Thursday. That's Group B, and we had some pretty crazy games coming out of this one. One of our fastest game of Worlds coming out of Longju this time. They are 3-0 at the top of the group. And that fastest time for them was 20:47. They could be doing a lot more of that.
Yeah, and that was with the first Nasus pick. Everyone's like, oh, yeah, he's going to scale. Nasus just keeps on stacking on minions. Okay, they're just going to do, you know, the fastest game that we've had here this year at Worlds.
Yep.
Third fastest, I believe, in the history
overall,
of the entire tournament.
The fastest tournament was 2015 EDG versus Bangkok Titans at 20:21. But here you can see just how quick Longju went to work in this game.
Yeah, Longju are just a fantastic team to watch play in all of their victories so far at Worlds. They've been quick, they've been decisive, they've hit their styles, and they're running away with it. They made Rift Herald dance in that game by killing the Nexus. People
not
don't even know that's
a thing. Not a common thing. Absolutely. So looking at what could actually happen in this group, Immortals 2-1 now, we do see them playing up against GAM to start things off, and I'm sure GAM, as always, going to come out firing.
That's the question, right?
They're
going to come out
firing.
Is
it a question, though?
I mean,
what are they going to have is the question.
Yeah, we had two games from them that were, you would say, a super cheesy, innovative, whatever you want to call it.
Right, right.
But
I
their
call it
third
the jam, the GAM jam. It's a good spread.
Yep,
it goes
jam.
Over the whole thing, not just one.
Yeah, and then, of course, without having GAM jam in game number
right,
three. That
right.
was the real confusing
that
part.
Was big.
They cheesed
they got
so
jammed.
Far, they almost came full circle and were no longer cheesing again. So
cheeses do come in wheels.
They definitely do. Well, they rolled around and they went to the other end. But will they do that in the next week is going to be my question. They've got 3 days to set that up and prepare based off what they've seen. They've got a sample size.
Right, and Kobe, giving you a tough one. Obviously, the opinion of Fnatic has been out there, but what is your opinion now of the team? 0-3, they're kind of turning on themselves here, even in the first week.
It looks pretty bad for Fnatic right now. All of the players are coming out on social media talking about they have these internal issues that they can't
right.
talk about. You know, there's a lot of unsolved things behind the scenes that contributed to some of the losses, and they talked about it today. So it actually looks very bad as far as even the internal organization for these guys right now. They're going to have to use this time, considering they're already 0-3 in between weeks, to try and not only fix all of their on-the-rift problems, but also all of their off-the-rift problems.
We've noticed that when people play different strategies against Fnatic, they really struggle to innovate and to adapt in the game itself. And then we notice that they're their best when someone is playing just completely standard against them. And even then, they still lost the game. So you really have to explore yourselves if you're Fnatic. It's not a lot of time to bounce back for them in particular, because it feels like the problems are just so fundamental.
All right, guys, before we close out week one here, I kind of just want to get a question, free grab from your brain, highlights, favorite moments, how you thought week one would have played out or did play out. Rusty, we'll start with you.
My pick'ems are all messed up, Riv. That's all I can really take from this. The one that's
great.
Always happy.
Those are great. Man, that's surprising. Mine's the Gnarlt. I would take the Gnarlt from Haunter as the one big thing that I noticed. It stood out above all the rest, and he timed it perfectly after a Taric ult went away. There was nothing that wasn't pretty about what Haunter did.
Kobe. I'm still in shock today of the top lane Nasus from Khan that got 300 stacks by like 15 minutes or something like that. That was actually insane. The fact that they have this scaling champion with one of the fastest games that we've ever had.
That's actually going to be mine. I am going to go for the third fastest game at Worlds. I favor thirds. It's just got to happen. And that happened between Longzhu and Fnatic. That was 2047. A fantastic time. That is going to do it for us here in Group 1, for Group Stage 1, Week 1 in Wuhan. Join us next week, same place, different times. Head over to lolesports.com to check out those times and all of the matches. I'm going to say for thank you for myself, Rusty, and Kobe here. Everybody, thank you for tuning in, and we will catch you next week. Good night.